Just before we really start in terms of the topic, yesterday we watched films, two films, and the one was Jungle Book. I said it there already. How important it is to have proper referencing. It doesn't really matter in that context. I said the one film is Jungle Book. It's more or less famous. Film story going back to a novel by Kipling, and I just checked on the internet, checked for the film, checked the animated cartoon version, and then I watched it and I was completely surprised about what I saw. It is going back to this book, but it is something completely different to what I thought it would be. There's another musical kind of version, which I expected, which I knew. So it's not enough to say Jungle Book. Everybody knows this film, everybody has an idea, but there are very different ideas around it. There are many things actually as well in such films, in both Ex Machina and Jungle Books, which in some way, one way or another, come up here in these lectures. The law of the jungle. It's a kind of model, and we will talk about models today. It's a kind of model, the idea of society we have. And we take this for granted and say this is the law of the jungle. This is the law of society. And we always have to be very careful about, is it the society in general or is it a very specific society? The relation to property that had been made in the film, seemingly without relevance in historical terms, meaning an ahistorical context, everybody strives for property, for private property, and then the matter of mutual support. It's as well something coming up there, and on the one hand, we just should enjoy these films. On the other hand, there is so much in it in terms of reflection and possibilities to reflect further. Then two minor, kind of minor issues. They may not be minor at some stage for you. Tests. You know the world is small. And I said it's up to you, the way you deal with the tests. It's an exercise for you. It's an offer for you if you want. They will go into the grading system. And as I said, the world is small. I heard the way you work is, at least not all, but at least some of you, one downloads the tests, has the question, you answer the questions, and you pass it on. Fine. Not fine, because you need the exercise. Unfortunately, I don't like it, but unfortunately, we are living in the system where you have to do the test, and one test will be you are sitting with half of the amount of people now in such a room. There is no way of cheating because there are four people running around and looking what you are doing. So you have to prepare yourself being able to answer the questions just being there on your own. That's the way it works. If you like it, if I like it, it doesn't matter. This is what you have to look for. So use it as well in this sense, please, just as an exercise to get used to this situation. Then as well, we talked a little bit about these texts, but not in detail going through the text. I mentioned now Engels' Socialism, Utopia, and Scientific, and the other from the Great Transformation from Polanyi. Read these texts. They may be relevant as well not only in terms of understanding what we are talking about, but as well in terms of exams at some stage. So, the question of economics and of academic work in general, it is something about values. And values have this strange character, in a way you may say a double character. In economics, we have a kind of relatively strict definition, what it is about, meaning it is the price that we have to pay for something. And this seems to be the value. But at the same time, there is the question of what determines actually this value. And this is one of the core questions in economics, throughout the entire economics, to say there are different ways of determining the value. And the one is, everyday's language, we value something. And the typical thing for valuing something that is not of any value is sentimental value. Believe it or not, I still have some stupid, I think it's a stone or a little branch my daughter once gave to me. It's completely meaningless if you would have it. But for me, it means something because of the situation when she gave it to me and how she gave it to me. So it's this kind of sentimental values. Or you collect stones or something at the beach. There are millions of stones, but these stones are valuable for you as a memory, as a souvenir on the situation. So we value something, although it doesn't have any value in objective terms. Now, determining the value means to look at this question, or the two questions first, from where do we come? Meaning, why is it valuable for us? What is the situation from which we come to determine the value? And the other is, what do we want to achieve with it? We talked about use value and exchange value. If we want to have something to sell, to exchange, we look, of course, at a different dimension of value than if we want to use it. Something may be very useful for us in subjective terms or in terms of what we are going to do, but it is not valuable in terms of exchange. A typical example are cars. My favorite was one in Italy, in Rome actually, which is not a huge city, but it's a city, congestion. And there had been people driving these ridiculously fast sports cars, Maserati, Lamborghini. Even walking, I was faster than they had been. Of course, walking, a couple of shoes, a pair of shoes, if you buy very expensive ones, they may cost, I don't know, 1,000 euro, but this is already something ridiculous that you have to search for this. Such a car costs, I don't know how many, tens of thousands. So in terms of exchange value, much more. But in terms of use value, just get a pair of shoes and walk. You are faster. The show-off effect is not as big, but this is how you access things as well. Available resources and means. What do we have at hand to use something, to produce something, and to do what we want to do? And then there is this factor of, do we actually value something in terms of the market, in terms of exchange, or do we look at the production, the cost of production? This will come up again and again in when we talk about economics proper. How do we obtain the resources? How do we obtain the values we are dealing with? I mentioned water in the desert, hugely expensive. But is it really only expensive because it is a rare, a scarce good? Or is it expensive, more expensive than diamonds to produce it there? So you have the different dimensions playing a role and going hand in hand with each other. Now looking at this, looking at the determination of value, we cannot just take a subjective impression. We have to look at a certain methodology and a certain research process. This is of crucial importance. It's not just taking what is there. This is, of course, what you do in the beginning. You read your textbook, you listen to lectures, and you look at the slides. But what all this is about and what is in the background of it is some thorough research which has a certain systematic. And this is something you will have to apply as well for your essays. We perceive something, yes. We see something, we hear something. We smell something. But we don't know really what it is about. So we have there the three dimensions of the epistemology. Now we are talking with these three dimensions about the methodology. From where do we know something? Is it just experience? Is it the knowledge of experience of others? Is it an assumption? And we are dealing with all these differences. But how does it relate to reality? This is something we have to know and we have to consider whenever we do research. And we have to be precise there to say, this is what I really know. And then we have to ask ourselves, why do I know it? Why can I say, I know this? To which extent is what I see valid for all situations, for all similar situations? What defines similarity? And then we come to stages as well in different disciplines, and economics is about combining differences, perspectives. We have a term law, and we use this term law in different ways. In legal science, which plays a role, we use it not in the same way as speaking of a natural law or as speaking of an economic law. Then we come to this matter of ontology. What does exist in this reality? It's not what do we perceive, but what is it? We come back to this later when we talk about abstraction. But we have to define what does really exist. Ideas, do they exist? Does it exist as fact that you are told, I don't know when, probably yesterday afternoon, you have to come to the lecture today? Is it just an idea, or what justifies us to say, yes, you will come? And then we have values. Values as well in terms of different interests. What do we want to achieve with our research? Why do we do it? And even if we just say, I want to find out how this functions, there's always this idea, I want to find out in order to be able to do something with it, in order to influence something or somebody, in order to make profit, in order to help somebody. And there you see how things are going together. Coming back to the test, actually, you may think I help somebody just giving the results of the tests. But in actual effect, you don't really help this person because you undermine the independent working on this. Now we have this, we have our perceptions, we have our different observations, and then come to the process of evaluation. And this can be simply a matter of looking at the figures, looking at statistics, looking at what we see, and then counting. How many people, how many students are coming here every time to the lectures? Is it always the same people who fail, who fail to come, or are there differences? Male, female students. We can just simply say, we observe, we evaluate what is happening. And then we come to this process of classification. And implicitly, I said already, there is some classification involved, talking about gender. Possibly talking about morning and evening times, classifying. And then, only then we put an interpretation on it. We look for the reason. We try to find a reason behind what is actually happening. And we have to be careful because we don't really know exactly what is happening. This is pretty much a matter of exactness of perception, of observation. But it is as well something of assumptions. One of my favorite examples, standing here in front of many people, many students, is that there are some people, they look at me, and I always get the impression they are really attending what I'm saying, and they're looking, and they're concentrating, and they're expressing that they understand something. And then I ask something, for instance, what did I just say? Huh? What? You mean? And then there are other people who give me the impression they are pretty disinterested, they don't follow, they are doing something else. And then I meet them possibly and ask them, why didn't you, did you understand what I said on this topic? And yeah, of course I did. You said that and that. So it's not always what we see, what we get. But we have to be careful with it. And from there we have to conclude, on the one hand, this is what we see, meaning what we think it is about, and this is something where we need more research, where we have to go further into detail. We talked about this, and well, there are other people here in the department, actually, who can do this much better. You know, remember? All the different cards. And there is this strange thing that if you put this in front, You have all the same cards. Now, if you look at it, if you look exactly at what I'm doing, it is relatively simple to find out half of the truth. You have to look very carefully, very precise at what is happening. But as I said, it's half of the truth. Going to the entire truth is a little bit more difficult. Then we come to something. When I saw it the first time, I was simply amazed by things we apparently see, and we can see, and at the same time, we don't have a clue really what is going on there.
Consider, for instance, this mysterious painting and that strange white blob at the bottom. But if we walk around the painting and stand at just the right spot, the blob is transformed and reveals itself to be the image of a human skull. We already have the center line, which is eye level for viewing the skull, but there's another line too, and here I'm referring to the really striking and perfectly geometric line made by the skull's jawbone. If we trace this line out, it will intersect the center line at a point which, in Kircher's notation, is called S. And this is the first of two points we need to uniquely determine a trapezoid grid, the other being point O. The idea here is that points S and O would have been used by Holbein to make the anamorphic projection of the skull we see in the painting. Therefore, in order to get back to the original skull, all we need to do is locate point O and perform the inverse transformation. Now, using the jawline to fix S defines a family of transformations where the resulting skulls all have jawlines that are perfectly horizontal. But we still need another condition in order to pin down the location of point O. So I decided it would look nice if the resulting skull had an aspect ratio of 1. That is, it should just fit inside a perfect square. This assumption seems reasonable, and our end result is, if I may say so, a mighty fine-looking cranium. But I kind of jumped out of my chair when I realized that this puts O in a spot that's actually meaningful. Because if we place the painting in a square 8x8 grid, then O will be located exactly 3 units to the right of the painting and exactly 1 unit above the center line. And when I say exact, I mean exact. The agreement is to within less than a millimeter, which is certainly within the precision of my measurement errors. And it seems exceptionally unlikely that any of this could have happened just by chance. The fact that this result, which was entirely unexpected, falls out so nicely suggests, I think, the entirely non-crazy possibility that maybe we really did stumble upon Holbein's actual technique for painting the skull. And if this is the case, then we have exact instructions for where to stand in order to see the skull properly.
It is kind of difficult to understand because What he actually does is he doesn't know if it works. He has a certain idea that it could work. And if you look at this painting, even if you look at the painting in the original, you won't really have an idea immediately what this is. It looks like lost, it looks like a faulty thing. But why it is important, observation is always a matter of perspective. And perspective is simply something, where do we stand in space? But it is as well something, where do our values are? From where do we come with our values? And then we can distinguish as well between appearance and the essence of something. The appearance is obviously something, it doesn't belong there. There may be something in it that Holbein in an excellent way painted. And then you have to go on, if you are into arts history, to interpret this. What does it mean in the entire context of this picture? So we cannot go into this. But it is important to look at observation, the perspective we take in terms of space, in terms of values, and the difference between appearance and essence. What is behind it? When we talk in language, we say, what is written between the lines? What is expressed behind the words? And then we have different ways, different schools, different paradigms that are used. And we have to go briefly through them. Briefly means you have to follow it up at some stage, a little bit now, a little bit in next year, and a little bit in 5 years, knowing as much as possible about it, not least taking into account there are two basic guidelines for scientific work. The one is, it's always about a link to practice. Any scientific work, any research is useless if it doesn't have any link to practice. Then there is another thing, it's about comparison. We always compare, even if we don't do it explicitly. We always compare, even if we have, or if we use language. If we use a term, and I was just doing it actually, we use a term, we use a word, implicitly, we compare. What is a term, what is a word? You may say it's just the same. If you think a little bit further about it, you'll see there is a difference between word and term. So implicitly we know and implicitly we compare things. Empiricism is what I said, where we usually or frequently start with. We see something. We smell something. It's a pleasant impression or not. We hear something. It's in many cases objective, meaning we can put a figure on it, the temperature. If something is loud, or we can measure how loud something is, decibel. But it does not mean anything in terms of our subjective perception. Something may be very loud, but we like to hear it, and we like to hear it loud. And we like it to hear it only loud, because if we hear it not as loud as is pleasant for us, we don't like the entire thing. It goes together. Music, you have often this case, that certain music you like to hear really, really loud, and if it's in the background, it's nothing. And in other cases, you hear something very loud, and you think this is noise. And if you would have it lower, you would say, this is beautiful. It depends on different things. It depends on the sender, meaning from where do we get the information. But it depends as well on our subjective perception, on our feeling about it. Deduction, linking premises with conclusions. If A equals B and B equals C, A, it includes it. We can deduct the relation between A and C. Because if A equals B, it's not similar to, it's equals. B equals C, then it's kind of necessary that A equals C. There is no causality involved. It's not because of, it's only the end. Then I said, we are talking about abstractions. I mentioned it earlier. Abstractions are a very important point in research, in study. We talked earlier, last time I think, about commodities. Commodities are an abstraction because you can have very different things that are a commodity. But we are not interested in microphones, in card decks, in chairs, in doors, but we are interested in the fact that there are commodities. I wrote here another example, a coat. A coat can be different things when we abstract from the fact it is a coat. A coat is something concrete and we can describe it. Actually, somebody asked me in the office, why do I wear the scarf? Is it too cold? I said, no, we from where I come, we are just born with a scarf. It's just outfit, it's fashion. It's not because it's cold and we need it. Garment, fashion. This means, again, we are talking about interest. Why are we looking at something in a specific way? For the one, a coat is a fashion look. For the other, it is a protection against cold. For the third one, it's a means on the market, he or she wants to sell it. So this is the direction of the interest that is included, that is involved in this process. One very important abstraction, and we come to this later in detail, is labor. In economics, we are not interested in labor as concrete labor. How do you work with it? What exactly are you doing? But we are interested. But we are interested in abstract labor, meaning in the process of creating, generating value. This is of interest in economics. We are not interested in the work, in the labor of the baker baking bread, but we are interested in this abstract labor of creating, of generating value. The concrete labor is baking bread. The abstract labor, baking bread, building a machine, is the same. The concrete labor is completely different. The concrete labor is about creation, creating something, and it is about bringing things together. Something that is, of course, relevant in terms of different contexts. I mentioned frequently the importance of context. And context is not least in economics given by history. Where do we stand in history? This provides a context. It's social orders, societal orders. It is political orders. It is technological orders as well. And there are two different dimensions of looking at history. It's important to keep this in mind as different ways. The one is considering the context and say we can understand things only if we explore the context, if we know how it is located in history. For you to go to study at a venture institute like Bangor College is kind of normal. Now, kind of normal, I say, because not everybody in China your age, not every student does it. But at least it is accessible, relatively easy. It's not tremendously expensive if you compare it with other studies. 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, it was something you couldn't imagine. There would possibly be one of you who would have been able to do it. When I was the first time taking an aircraft to fly, I was, I think, 32. My daughter was about 3. That's historic context. So you can understand the value, if you want, of traveling, the meaning of traveling, only if you know the historic context. Today, in most of the European countries, if you say, I never traveled by air, people would say, well, this is a little bit strange, and kind of, it's so common, and why didn't you do it? 50 years ago, nobody would have asked, why didn't you do it? It was more the other way around. Wow, you traveled already, you had been using an aircraft, you traveled by air. The other dimension, it's historicism, is about, we don't look at the context, but we say actually the way things develop is predetermined and basically it's automatically going on in history. We don't have to do much. Things happen and there's a kind of automatic historical process. This is important as well when it comes to research. I talked at least implicitly or en passant about different theories, different paradigms in economics. Adam Smith was one of the founding fathers of economics, and there was more or less recently a book published 200 years later or something like this about Smith in Beijing. It analyzes or tries to analyze with a theory of many, many years ago the situation, what is going on today in China. It's a very interesting book. It's a very critical book. Critical about towards Smith, critical about the global development. It's actually not so much looking at China, it's looking at China as well, but it's more looking at the global dimensions. But there we have to be careful always. If we take a theory, we always have to think about the context as well. In which context was this theory developed? From where did it emerge? Is it linked to the reality and in which way? Can we simply say we use this, what had been developed 100 years, 200 years ago, today? If so, can we just use it as it is or do we have to modify it? And there is this, with history, as I said, the one important shift was that to individualism. before, individuals didn't matter in the same way, at least, as we matter today. You had been subject to the Queen. You are still in England, you are still subject to the Queen. But meaning, even earlier, you had been owned by somebody. And then the shift to be a personality, you have your rights as individual. And with this, the idea is you have to look after yourself. In this way, history matters. History matters in terms of what are the obligations of others, sometimes legal obligations, sometimes just moral obligations, the way we do it. We look after the elderly who need care. And there is this, in economics, the idea of the greatest happiness, I mentioned this, utilitarianism, that only the individual is rationally looking after him herself, is not interested in others. And if we look around, leaving certain exceptions aside, looking after the elderly, looking after children, looking after people who are helpless for whatever reason, in general, we have this, yes, it is just me, I have to look how I get on. So in this way, I should support your idea of supporting your fellow students and not looking after yourself, but looking after the others and helping them. And indeed, the question is, it is not, or is it really the individual looking after him herself, or, and this is one alternative, is it this orientation on maximizing social standing? It's not the amount of commodities I possess, but it is, and in this way the Lamborghini makes sense, it is how others assess me, what others think about me. And if I stand in the traffic jam with my beautiful Lamborghini, everybody says, well, wow, this is a car, really great. If I walk along, nobody will notice me. This is how we buy as well products. So it's not the rational behavior in the strict sense, it doesn't make sense to spend so much money on this car, but it is what do I get out of it in terms of social value. But now we can go on and move to another level and say this social standing is not just having something that is more expensive, that is better or whatsoever than others have, but it is as well the support I give to others. It is how I link into network, how I work together with others. So this is something we are permanently occupied, employed with. We are talking about models. We are talking about these terms of utilitarianism, or we talk about revolutionary changes, evolutionary changes. They can only be understood if we look at things in a certain context. And this is what we do now with this one quote. Economists of the 17th century, for instance, always begin with the living whole. Just read this through. With population, nation states, several states, etc. Something we know we always use in daily life. But they are always conclude that discovering through analysis a small number of determinant, abstract, general relations such as division of labor, money, value, etc. As soon as these individual moments had been more or less firmly established and abstracted, there began the economic system, systems which ascended from the simple relations such as labor, division of labor, need, exchange value, to the level of the state, exchange between nations and the world market. This is what we will continue, where we will continue then after the break.